Hello everyone, I'm Tamika Weatherspoon here one-on-one with Janet Groth, a professor and writer. Her book, The Receptionist, an Education at the New Yorker, chronicles her 21 years at that iconic magazine. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Tamika. It's lovely to be here.
You started out as this aspiring writer in Minnesota. How did you come to work at the New Yorker?
Well, it was a very lucky chance. I had one contact when I came to New York, and it turned out that when he received my resume from Minnesota, he was up in Maine fishing with his good friend E.B. White, who happened to be lord, really, of all at the New Yorker, with the exception of the editor-in-chief himself. Mr. White was revered beyond anything there. People will know him from Charlotte's Web and his children's books, but he was writing his essays for years at the New Yorker before that, and he never saw people to hire people for the job. He just did a favor to his fishing friend, and there I was.
So it's all about who you know, not necessarily
well,
what you
I'm
know.
Well, I'm afraid so, yes.
So what was it like, the culture, getting started at the New Yorker in 1957? A lot of people compare that era to Mad Men.
So, what do you fellas do?
You're looking at the finest ad men in New York.
All you have to do is imagine linoleum instead of carpet, very scruffy offices. They did a kind of a reverse chic thing. We are above surface glitz at the New Yorker. So there was none of that high-rise, floor-to-ceiling window behind anybody. Beyond that, the sense of privilege that men moved in and out of offices with, and the way the secretarial pool was more or less fair game, all that was exactly the same.
What were you expecting when you interviewed for a job at the New Yorker?
Well, I went with ambitions to be a writer. I was a little different from other people who would have gone and maybe wanted to be talk of the town reporters or to write for the magazine in a kind of journalistic way. I wanted to be a novelist, and I had a novel in the drawer, and so I didn't, that was one reason why I didn't submit to the magazine for so long, but there were other psychological reasons. When I was there, I was pretty intimidated by the fact that James Thurber was there, St. Clair McKelvey was there, a man named Joseph Mitchell, with whom I later actually became friends and had many, many literary lunches. But these were all fabulous and well-established writers, and it was hard to imagine myself competing in that field.
When they offered you a position, were you expecting the job that you got and to stay as long as you did?
There was that old "can you type" business. And I have since had wonderful talks with women who went to the New Yorker about that time and got into the typing pool and stayed in the typing pool. So I think I was right in saying I didn't want to type, didn't want to know how to type, so I wouldn't be in the typing pool. But that's as far as my plan went, and it did put me in the area of action with the writers, which was the most exciting part of my job, neither there nor the typing pool was a good stepping up place for women in those days.
Now, you were there from 1957 through 1978.
That's correct, yes.
And that's pre-feminist era.
Pretty much. The feminist revolution was getting off the ground in the 70s, but the Oprah and her assertiveness training was left in the future. I wonder what would have happened if I'd had a little assertiveness training. That would have been wonderful.
Now, there's this theme in the book, who was taking advantage of whom? Your salary wasn't, you know, something of today.
Shall we say, I think it was something like $88 a week to begin and $136 or something like that to 21 years later a week.
Sure, but you also had a lot of amazing experiences while you were there that were irreplaceable.
Well, yes, it would have been very difficult to put a price on, let's say the time that Muriel Spark, the novelist of the prime of Miss Jean Brodie, who asked me, by the way, to be her private secretary. She didn't seem to mind that I had to touch type, and we became good friends. She asked me to a party in Rome when she moved to Italy that would have been very hard to put a price on. There were European royals there. The Italian film people were there. I had a little drink of white wine with Michelangelo Antonioni. I don't know. You don't put prices on things like that.
And you also pursued an education while you were at the magazine.
That's right. I did. Well, I was completely clueless about how to work student loans and grants and that sort of thing. I just thought you had to pay your tuition as you signed up for a course. So I signed up for a course, one course at a time, and 15 years later I was ready for my doctorate.
After you pursued teaching at the University of Cincinnati, was that a difficult decision to leave the magazine?
No, by that time, really. I mean, it was high time. You could say, many people would say, well, I should have left long ago, but through this course of psychoanalysis, I was maturing. I was getting a perspective on just what had stopped me from my own advancement at the magazine. And I was ready, more than ready, to leave the cocoon, the kind of protected atmosphere that the New Yorker was, and to step out into the world and give something back.
Now you've worked with a number of students. Do you have any advice that you would give to young people wanting to join the media industry?
Well, be prepared for a lot of pressure. And with any luck, you'll handle that better than I did. But I think this business about excellence and there being no substitute and no shortcut toward success in achieving that excellence, just have to really buckle down and devote yourself.
Well, Janet, thank you for joining us.
You're so welcome. Thank you, Tamika.